Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, you can do better than that. Praise the Lord, everybody. All right. Football is over. It's worshiping time. Praise the Lord, everybody. Bible says that everything that has breath, praise ye the Lord. One Psalm even says that I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Y'all know what I'm talking about? And so since we're in the house of the Lord, we're ready to have praise and worship and give honor unto him. Amen. Good morning, good morning, good morning. All of you look beautiful, handsome, if I may say. Amen. But we're here to have a glorious time in the Lord. Amen. At this time, we're going to have our opening prayer. Amen. By Reverend Jack Davis. And then after that, we'll have our Black History Litany from our own pastor, Pastor Danny L. McKenzie. In that order, amen.
Let us pray. Our God and our Father, we thank you for your goodness and your kindness and your grace and your mercy. Your God that sees and a God that cares. And for that, Lord God, we tell you thank you. We thank you that you is our God, our Father and our Lord, and that you rule in our lives. Lord God, we thank you that we're your people, we're a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. You called us out of darkness into your marvelous light. And for that, Lord God, we tell you thank you. We thank you for this month, Black History Month, but every month is Black History Month because we're your people. And for that, God, we tell you thank you. We thank you for the one that fought for us, Lord God, for our civil rights. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., John Lewis, Rosa Parks, and many, many more, Jesse Jackson, and it's a whole lot, Lord God. For that, we tell you, thank you, Lord God. We thank you for where you brought us from, for where you're taking us to, and by faith, we thank you for where you're leading us, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We thank you for your grace and your mercy. Lord God, we thank you for everyone that is here. We thank you for the one that is on the way. Lord God, we ask you to show up in a mighty way. That your Shekinah glory fall in this sanctuary. Move by your spirit, Lord God. Have your way in this service. And the woman of God that is going to bring the message, Lord God, speak to her and speak through her. Word of mouth and give her what to say. Do it for your honor and for your glory. Do it because you're God and because you bless us to be your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God and amen.
Come on, let every heart say amen. Come on, say it like you mean it this morning. Come on, say it like the Lord woke you up, clothing in your right mind. Blood still running warm in your veins. Come on, did we come to worship him in spirit and in truth? Amen, amen, amen. If you would, please stand for our Black History Litany. It's on the inside of our printed program. You shall read the leader portion, you shall read the congregation, and then when we get down to the end, we shall all read together. O God, you have heard the anguished cries of our ancestors. Their sounds echo and penetrate time to remind us of our foreparents, who were brutally captured and forcibly enslaved, as they left the peaceful womb of their African homeland. O God, you have seen the millions of dark bodies buried beneath the tumultuous waves of the deep, bodies of African men and women who held the seas of greatness. You have seen women's dreams for a united family vanish as they were sold at auction blocks. You have seen the legacy of the African American family decimated and demeaned by those who have attempted to control our destiny. O God, you have ignited the sparks within us into a blazing demand for freedom, equality, and justice. This quest caused Harriet Tubman sleepless nights as she led her people to freedom. It was an equality that Rosa Parks and civil rights activists fought for and gave their lives for. It was a justice that Martin Luther King Jr. stood for as thousands stood with him at the Lincoln Memorial.
Yet with the steady beat, have not our weary feet come to the place which is our Father's side.
O God, you answered us during our exodus from Africa.
You wiped every teardrop during our exile and captivity. Our foreparents dared to dream that one day on these shores we would become politicians, preachers, educators, doctors, writers, scientists, artists, and so much more.
Let's not reach straight from the places our God will be making.
Our ancestors' hard work, their courage, their convictions, and their belief, and you paved the way for our emancipation and education. But it is clear you have liberated us. You have set us free. Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, I'm free at last. Lest our hearts drunk with the wine of the world, we forget thee. Shadow beneath thy hand, may we forever stand true to our God and true to our native land.
Thank you. Come on. Come on, you can do it better than that. Come on, saints of God.
Nothing like a good praise and worship. Amen. To get the blood that's warm in your veins flowing for the God who saved you. Saints of God, I'm going to ask you to stand with me. Amen. All that can and all that will. I want you to put the two things that God has given you to grab a hold to something. I want you to put those hands together for the one and only Florida Memorial Gospel Choir. As they come in. Amen for us on today. Amen. To God be the glory. It is beautiful, amen, when there's a connection in place that you can have a wonderful choir like this come and spend some time with us. Amen, somebody. Amen. Thank God for the connection. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. We thank this wonderful choir for joining us on this morning. Saints of God, we're going to have an introduction of our anthem from this morning, coming from Sister Patricia Carter. Amen, as you come. Come on, we can do much better than that. But maybe this is singing. She's the former president of our Women's Auxiliary for the Florida General Baptist Convention. Come on, none other than Sister Patricia Carter, the late wife of the Reverend Matt King Carter. Amen. Let's give them some love. Give her some love. Amen. Hallelujah. We're honored to have her with us on today. God bless you. Amen.
Good morning. Feeling so nostalgic. My Negro this morning and thinking about Dr. Monroe. The first time that we came for this scholarship fundraising. I see some hands. Some of you all were at Mount Nebo and you're still faithful now. I'm not going to tell you how long, but I'm not the speaker, so I've got some sense a little bit anyway. It's out of Colorado, Pastor Maggie McKenzie, our esteemed speaker, Dr. Oscar, for this morning, for Memorial, and Dr. Jackson. My home church, New Birth, Miami. Just a good morning to all of you. And I'm glad to our choir and choir director to share these few remarks about the history of this song that we know as the Negro National Anthem. Over 20 years of traveling with Corral and on cold buses. That's probably why I can't walk now to cold buses, all those places across the country. We went from New York to Seattle, Detroit, and all those places. That's probably our privilege. But James Golden Johnson, that name is probably more familiar to you than his brother, John Rosenman. Both of them were born in Jacksonville, Florida. And in these few minutes, I'll try to give you a snippet of how they are so connected to what we know today as Florida Memorial University. James Wilder's name, if you look up history of the NAACP, his name is very prominent in the establishment and the work of the NAACP. Born in 1875, he was a lawyer, poet, diplomat. His brother, John Rosenman Johnson, was a composer, a singer, and both of them were very prominent for what's known as the Harlem Renaissance. The lyrics were written by James Weldon Johnson in 1900, and check my dates, members know what it is for me. 1900, and it was set to music 5 years later by his brother, John Roslyn Johnson. It was a song, and really a poem, that speaks joyfully about hope and resilience of Black people, that despite so many unthinkable cruelties that were suffered, our ancestors were resilient. They were able to bounce back. They were able to endure. They were able to make something out of nothing. Nothing fills me with more than positive fear and trepidation than hearing Black people say, oh, that was then and this was now. And I'm not the speaker. But speaking about hope, Roslyn was born in 1873 and lived until 1954. Very prominent in the musical, William Bess, that Renaissance period there. Their father was named James Johnson Sr. Their mother, Helen Moulter. And sidebar about Helen, she is the first Black female teacher in the state of Florida. She taught at Stanton, even on the roots of Jacksonville. History. I can stand back around me. She taught at Stanton in Jacksonville. Now, this song was first performed in 1914. They used to celebrate Abraham Lincoln's birthday. And at that time, the name was Florida Baptist Academy. And Lincoln's birthday, and that would be a good conversation for some of the historians, because we know Lincoln was not all that we made him out to be. But anyway, part of the establishment of what we know now as Florida Memorial was for instruction of ministers and students. In 1892, because of racial unrest in St. Augustine, the Florida Baptist Convention made a decision to move the school. And history has a way of repeating itself. The school was shot up by the Ku Klux Klan. And they made the decision to move and merge with an existing institution in Jacksonville. And a late Dr. Collier hired Roslyn to teach music at the institution. Their father later became the president, and he was president in 1914 when they had the Lincoln Day celebration. And this song was first performed for the Lincoln Day birthday celebration in 1900. We know the school later went back to St. Augustine for a while. And this is a real sidebar. I never did like those students at Florida Normal in those days because I didn't get a chance to meet Martin Luther King because of the movement that was underway at the Florida Normal campus. We were waiting in Ocala for King to come. And the organizers determined that it was too dangerous for him to travel through the Ocala National Forest to Ocala. So I was real mad at them. I don't know why I stayed there more than 30 years. But let me conclude by saying, students, you stand on some great shoulders of students who have represented this institution across the country, Europe, Bahamas, France, and other places across the world. And I hope as you travel on with Dr. Jackson's help and anybody that I still know up there, you will get a chance to visit the campus there, both at Live Oak and at St. Augustine. It's important that we know from whence we came. And who goes from here? And Madam Director?
Sister and the Elmont Road created the Joy Scholarship so that any child ages 3 through 12 can the occasion this morning is to celebrate the legacies of two persons through the Mount Nebo Joy Scholarship. They are Reverend Dr. Moses E. Monroe and Sister Edna L. Monroe. The theme is I Am the Dream. Our Black history here at Mount Nebo tells us for that 57 years he pastored, and for 6 years, he was the pastor emeritus. And for his service of 63 years, the oldest church on the block has had the city to name the street after him. I would like to introduce Pastor Monroe and Edna Elmont. Along with his 7 children, the first being Moses Jr., the second, Edna May,
oh, yeah.
The third, James. The fourth, Daniel. The fifth, Jeanette. The sixth is Nathaniel. And the seventh is Shirley. Pastor Monroe traveled Sunday after Sunday from Goose, Florida to preach the word, not by turnpike, not by I-95, but by the federal highway. He loved the children so much, a community's children fellowship was started at Mount Nebo for any child who wanted to come join. Monroe's joy. Jewels of youth. Reverend Monroe was called home on June 17th, 2017. So today, the youth would like to leave these words with you. Youth, are you ready? Hey, Mount Nebo, have you heard?
Hey, Mount Nebo, have you heard?
Pastor Monroe preached the word.
Pastor Monroe preached the word.
He was here for 57 years.
Preaching the word and sharing tears.
Preaching the word and sharing tears. Hey, Mount Nebo, have you heard?
Hey, Mount Nebo, have you heard?
Pastor Monroe preached the word.
Pastor Monroe preached the word.
He was here for 57 years.
He was here for 57 years.
Preaching the word and sharing tears. Thank you to Pastor Danielle McKenzie for carrying on the dream. And now our future. I am the dream. Youth.
I am the dream.
Youth.
I'm
today. Come on, y'all looking at me funny. I've been believing on today that God made you. And it's a reason why you don't look like the other person. That you may not be tall or short like the other person. Amen, somebody. Y'all need to get down on the way home. Amen. At this time, we're going to have the educators' acknowledgement from our high schoolers. We have Christopher Elliott and Brandon Gordon. Amen. You can come in that order.
Good morning. My name is Christopher Elliott. We want to acknowledge everyone who has worked in the education or any school system, helping the youth. Please stand so we may celebrate during this education hour. Thank you.
Amen. I don't know about you, but I definitely work for the Broward County Public Schools. Amen. If I can be able to help, I try to help. Amen. Next, we're going to have greetings. This young lady is the wife of one of the pastors down in Miami. Amen. Pastor Alfonso Jackson Jr. Amen. And his wife here, Mrs. Dr. Jamelia Jackson, is going to come before us with greetings. Amen. She is the Dean of Campus, Faith-Based Coordinator for the Florida Memorial University. Amen. Put your hands together for her.
Good morning, Nalibo. We bring greetings to Pastor McKenzie and Reverend Caldwell and Sister Carter. Can we praise God for the wonderful job that the young people are doing thus far? To God be the glory. Can we praise God for our Florida Memorial Chorale and our director? To God be the glory. Well, I bring you greetings from Florida Memorial University from President Japhis Hardrick, Provost Hill, and VP Corey Witherspoon. We bring you greetings on this wonderful celebration of Black history. I want to share a few things that are happening on the campus of Florida Memorial University, starting with the biggest wonderful thing that we could ever imagine. For the past two semesters, we have been bringing in our largest freshman class onto our campus. This has been the largest class in the last 15 years. And we are praising God for his favor on Florida Memorial University. As you have heard, we've got a wonderful band, our Roar Marching Band, ranked number one in Division II by the ESPN. Now that's a big deal. And if you ever see them in action, you can see that God has truly blessed them. We have our band going to Paris this summer by the grace of God. And then we can't say enough about our chorale. They are all over the city, all over the nation. God has them on high demand, and they have really given a lot of time and energy to their calling to sing the gospel and bless the people of God. Just last night, our girls basketball team became the Sun Conference champions. They celebrated a great victory, and they were ecstatic about what God has blessed them with. And then I want to share that Florida Memorial University has made history by hiring their first female chaplain. And I am so blessed. I'm so blessed to be serving the students and caring for them as they grow spiritually. We're doing a lot of amazing things at Florida Memorial University. Our president is doing an amazing job, and he's going to be serving with us for another 5 years, and we praise God for that. special inauguration never took place because of COVID and the pandemic. So he will be having an inauguration on the third week of March. So on March 17th at Florida Memorial University, all of you are invited to join us in the Wellness Center. You have to register. So if you go on the Florida Memorial University webpage, www.fmuniv.edu, you can register and be a part of that wonderful inauguration. And all of the events are listed there. We've got new programs and we've got new partnerships. And I just want to conclude by sharing one special partnership that is near and dear to my heart. It is the Lift Every Voice Theological Education Partnership. This partnership is with Palm Beach Atlantic University. So the two universities who put God first have come together to offer outstanding theological education opportunities. If you always wanted your bachelor's degree and you never were able to do it, if you always wanted your master's of divinity, you were serving in the church, you wanted to learn more about God, and you've never been able to do it, now we have an opportunity for you, a theological program at our very own HBCU in South Florida. There are professors that are from our community. As a matter of fact, we've got Pastor Keelan Duke as our professor now. We've had Dr. Marcus Davidson as teaching two of our classes. We have Pastor Alfonso Jackson Sr. on the FMU campus with our bachelor students. And we've got just so much to offer. We've got partial scholarships at the MDiv level. We have wonderful courses in Black Church Studies. And you will have support as you apply, as you get into the program, and as you move your way to a wonderful graduation. We are here to support you, and we ask that you please take advantage of this opportunity to get your degrees from Florida Memorial University in partnership with Palm Beach Atlantic. There are flyers at the side table if you're interested. All you have to do is send an email, go to the website, put your information, and someone will be contacting you. I thank God for what he's doing at Florida Memorial University. That is our HBCU down here in South Florida. And please pray for us. We lost three of our students. There were accidents that took place off campus. Please pray for our student body and keep them in your hearts, because they are experiencing some hard times with that loss. And we are excited about hearing from Dr. Osgood, and we're glad to be in the building today. Thank you.
Amen, amen. Thank you for the greetings. Amen. Next we're going to have up is Dear Mount Nebo Facts and Dear Black History Facts. We're going to have Dylan Caldwell is going to come, Keedra Willis, and Sister Cora Johnson is going to come. After that, we're going to hear from these lovely voices that are behind me. Amen. The Florida Memorial Gospel Choir.
Good morning.
Good morning.
In honor of Black History for school, I researched William B. Purvis. Although Mr. Purvis did not invent the fountain pen in 1890, he patented improvements to it. The new pen eliminated the need for people to carry an ink bottle by storing ink within the pen. What we all are familiar with today. William B. Purvis also successfully patented a number of other inventions. Now you know.
Good morning. Kamala Harris was born on October 20, 1946 in California. She was a lawyer and senator. In 2021, she was the 49th Vice President of the USA. Joe Biden chose her in November 21st. She became the first Black woman elected as President of the United States.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Mount Nebo is blessed to have members in our congregation that are 90% of the state. Thank you. Mount Bebo is blessed to have members in our congregation that have a great age of 90 plus. And today, we'd like to give honor and celebration to them as well. The Bible says our earthly bodies become weary as we age, and we may also notice aches and pains. But take comfort in knowing the Lord shall renew your strength. And according to Isaiah 40:31, then you will soar with wings like an eagle, and you will run and not grow weary, and walk and not faint, and not grow tired. I leave with you, Job 12:12 says, wisdom belongs to the age and understanding to the old. As I call you up, please state your age. Thomas Kearney, Deacon Thomas Kearney. Deacon Kearney, come on and show out. Come on.
You deserve it.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Moving on to God. Our Maker, our Creator, our great Sustainer. That's why I'm here today.
Amen.
I thank God for the longevity I've been here at my people. I moved here in 1970. I was looking for a church that really was to worship. And I've been here ever since, and I enjoyed this service right here at this church. I'm sorry to tell you all this, but I want you to know it. I thank God that it laid on my heart for my family and I to worship here at Mount Bebo for these number of years. And I just thank God.
Okay, what am I going to do next? I'm going to call the... Oh, you can tell us how old he was. That's what you're supposed to tell.
As of now, I'm 91 years old.
Monroe Scott, Sister Early Washington, and Roxelle Bradwell, Cleveland Washington, and Alfonso Gaynor, and Elizabeth Jones.
Is
90 years old. If he's not feeling well, please keep him in prayer. Also, we have Alfonso Gaynor and Elizabeth Jones. We want to keep them in prayer as well. Thank you. Next, we're going to have Ms. Earlene Washington, and she's going to stay her age, and we're going to tell you that she's one of our special ones. We'll tell you about her in a minute.
My name is Sister Ruth Washington. I was born March 15th, 1934.
She may not be the oldest one standing here, but she is the oldest in attendance standing here as a member of Mount Nebo. So you might have to respect that, right?
No man can I deny.
McDuffie, which is the son of the late author McDuffie, Miami, Florida. And then after that, we're going to have the African Folk Dance, Have Mercy, Jelena Pittman. Amen, Lord.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. To God be the glory for the things that he's done. I bring you greetings from the Second Kingdom Missionary Baptist Church, where I serve as the minister of music, and Reverend Jeffrey L. Mack is my pastor. To the pastor of this house, to the officiaries that are present, to Director Pittman, who I love dearly, and to everyone in their respective places, good morning, good afternoon. I want to thank you for this opportunity, and I solicit your prayers as well. I would also like to take a moment to acknowledge Philip Moore University. Amen. I actually just completed a 6-year contract with Philip Moore. So something about a year, I would say. So I know many of them up there. Amen. I know a lot of them. Yes. Amen. I stand at this time to speak briefly about my father, Arthur McDuffie. Often when we think of police brutality, we think of the most current things. We think of everyone who's been in the news the past couple of years, but many don't know, unless you was actually around at that time, that police brutality has been an ongoing issue. And it is very shameful that we are still dealing with police brutality, even in 2023. Many of us knew when 1980s and 1990s, 2000s was gonna look something different. Speaking of spaceships and things of that nature, however, here we are. But I'll tell you this, we are here by the grace of God. And I give him praise. I am the youngest of 3 siblings. I do have 2 sisters. Cedrica McDuffie is a pastor in Miami, Florida. And my sister, Dewan McDuffie, is a teacher from Miami-Dade Public Schools, and she studied for a doctorate degree. Amen. On December 17, 1979, Arthur McDuffie, a 33-year-old insurance agent and former Marine, was beaten into a coma by white Dade County police officers after McDuffie ran a red light on his motorcycle. The officers immediately tried to cover up their crime to stage it as an accident. McDuffie sadly died several days later from his injuries. An investigation led to the officer's arrest when the medical examiner said McDuffie's injuries were not consistent with the motorcycle crash and that McDuffie had not fallen off the motorcycle as police said. The medical examiner also determined that McDuffie had been beaten to death. Six officers were indicted for manslaughter as well as tampering with or fabricating physical evidence. A seventh was charged with tampering with evidence. Acting Director of the Dade County Public Safety Department, Bobby Jones, suspended the officers on December 27th. He said that since 1973, four of the officers have been cited in 47 citizen complaints and 13 internal affair probes. Two other officers were charged with being accessories to the crime, as well as fabricating evidence. Due to racial tension in Miami, the trial was moved to Tampa, Florida. Sadly, 5 months after McDuffie was buried, an all-white jury in Tampa acquitted officers, saying that the state failed to prove his case. After the verdict, over 5,000 people began to protest in Miami. The protest eventually turned into a riot. Three people were killed and at least 23 injured, with several of those in critical condition. The riots drew international attention. The National Guard was called in to calm the city and the neighborhoods that were set aflame. Many in Miami's black communities bitterly recall how justice was not served in McDuffie's case. I take a moment here to say my grandmother, who passed a number of years ago, came to Miami, and whenever she would come to Miami, she would always say, "I would rather not be in the city. Please let me stay in Broward County or somewhere else." Whenever we would ask her why, it would be the same line that she said on TV many years ago, "They beat him like a dog." In 1981, they contemplated McDuffie's family a settlement after they filed a civil lawsuit against the officials. The 1980 riots were the deadliest since the 1960s and remained subject to the 1992 Los Angeles riots 12 years later. And once again, it's sad that we are still dealing with police brutality. What I will say with my family is we're very prayerful that one day a change will come. We do our very best to put our trust in God despite everything. As children, being very young, when the situation happens, sometimes it's hard to speak about because we don't have a lot of the facts, but I thank God for history and I thank God for my family who's instilled in me how great my father was and the details surrounding his death. I also want to say that in 2003, the city of Miami decided to name 17th Avenue after Lee McDuffie Avenue. And in 2020, the city of Miami also named February 2nd as Arthur Lee McDuffie Day. We are here to represent. We are very grateful for every measure that the community has taken to pay homage to our father. But once again, we are definitely prayerful, and we pray that one day a true change will come. I thank you all for your time. Good afternoon.
Very grateful to be here today. My name is Jelena Pittman. Thank you. No relation to Miss Celia Pittman here, but it's a blessing that she asked me to be here. I'm gonna perform this dance. Every time I've heard it, it had a different meaning. The song is Have Mercy, and I believe it's like the perfect segment after Mr. Duffy has just spoken. It's just a moment that every time I hear it, it goes from giving thanks for the blessings to saying that we still have more to achieve and more to keep going. And I hope that you enjoy it. I do apologize in advance. There is a lot of low movement, so if you're in the back, you might want to stand up and get a little closer. But I hope you enjoy it, and thank you for having me.
I'm guessing.
face of God. Next, we're going to have the introduction of our speaker for today, my sister Earlene Horn. We'll have our scripture, then we'll have a song of praise, again from these beautiful voices. And then we will hear from this dynamic speaker. Amen. Amen.
To God be the glory. Amen. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Amen. Amen. Thank you all for being here with us this morning. And as my task is, I have a very easy task. Because I was voluntold, first of all, that I was going to introduce this person, because she told them I was going to introduce her. And since her mother is actually my classmate, and that means I'm older than she is, and I can tell her what to do, but she got a chance to tell me what to do tomorrow. So I am honored to introduce our messenger for this morning. And you all can Google her for yourself and find out all the marvelous things that she has done and what she continues to do in our community. And she has served as on the school board for 10 years or more, and she was the chair, and she's now a state senator. And all of this everything that she's done. She is the CEO of MODCO, Minority Development Corporation. And she's one of the first associate ministers, female ministers at Mount Olive, where Dr. Marcus Davidson is her pastor. But today I want to share with you, based on our Sunday school lesson this morning, it told us about a marvelous life. And this young lady actually represents that. But ye are chosen, a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into the marvelous light. You all can Google her and learn her story about all the trials and tribulations that she endured and what she went through in her life. She tells you what she went through. But today you look at her and you can see that she has come into the marvelous light of our Lord and Savior. You don't know her story, but I can tell you today that she speaks for herself, and her story speaks for her. She is a true woman of God. She is a prayer warrior. We pray together every Wednesday and Friday mornings with our sorority, Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, where she serves as the president. She is a true woman of God. She prays with the Republicans every Wednesday morning, trying to make our state a better place for us to live. She is a true woman of God. She does not hide her religious beliefs. She lets them know where she stands and who she serves, because she is a true woman of God. I know her. For myself, I knew her before she was even born. So I know this young lady who is going to bring you the message this morning, because she is a true woman of God. And I would like to thank her personally, because when we did not have a pastor, this woman of God would come to Mount Evo Missionary Baptist Church and share the word with our congregation whenever we needed her and whenever we called her, because she is a true woman of God. Without further ado, it is my esteemed pleasure to present to you and to introduce to some a true woman of God, my sorority sister, my daughter, my friend, Dr. Rosalind Osgood, State Senator for District 32. A true woman of God. Thank you.
Talking and she mentioned a scripture. I said, well, I can't read that one. I kind of had that one in mind. But there's another one that comes to mind. You would stand with me for the reading of God's word. I think that this scripture is going to go with 1 Peter 2:9, where it said that we are peculiar people. Micah chapter 6, verse 8, just one verse, says these words. He has showed thee, O man, what is good, and what doeth the Lord require of thee, but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God. May the Lord bless the hearers and most of all the doers of his word. You may be seated. After we hear from these lovely, lovely, lovely voices, I ask that you stand for the woman of God that's going to come and bring the word on today. Amen.
Come on, let's put our hands together. Thank you.
that it was rooted in culture that we saw the young people doing and living for the Lord. We thank God for the leadership of this church. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We give honor to Pastor McKenzie, to Reverend Conwell, Reverend Davis, to Elder Knox, Elder Patrice Johnson, all of you in your respective places. Certainly, I want to thank my special guests, the Women of Veterans Affairs, and I'm going to ask them to stand for being here this morning. This is a group of female Black women veterans. I want you to look at them. We can do better than that. You may be seated. Ms. Glenn just happens to also be a member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, the Zeta Rho Omega chapter. Certainly we want to honor Sister Patricia Carter, former president of the Florida General Baptist Convention. It is always a delight to be in her presence. I'm just deliciously proud that she's here with us this morning. And certainly to another one of my mentors in the person of Miss Erlene Striggles-Horn, who knew me before I knew myself. Thank you so much for that arousing introduction. I have my aunt and one of her friends here today. Thank you for being here. And thanks to all of you in your respective places this morning for being here in the house of the Lord one more time. We know that someone did not wake up last night, but we're here this morning as well. And certainly want to give honor to Miss Odessa Bennett for being here this morning, another member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated. And we're just elated to be in your midst this morning. There is a word from the Lord this morning. If you would go with me to Paul's letter to the church of Philippi, Philippians chapter 3, and I'm going to begin reading at verse number 13. And I want us to certainly praise God for Sister Pittman, who has been on this journey with the Long People for a long time, and not only that, the director of the youth department for the Florida General Baptist Convention. She's been doing this work with our youth for over 30 years, and we certainly thank her and appreciate her for speaking to the basics. When we saw young people giving speeches and participating in the program today. Philippians chapter 3, and I'll begin reading at verse number 13, and I'll read two verses, 13 and 14. Brethren, I do not regard myself as having laid a hold of it yet, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and reaching forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal of the prize of the upward call in Christ Jesus. For those of you that are subject-minded this morning, I want to talk to you from the subject, finishing well. The theme for today is, I am the dream. We all are a part of the dream. And if we're going to actualize the dream, we must finish well. I heard Brother McDuffie up here. I remember I was a young girl when that riot took place. I didn't understand the violence. I didn't understand how such a cruel thing could happen to a person. And the older I've gotten, I see it happening more and more. But we as people of God, we're going to have to finish well. Paul, in this particular pericope, approaches this pericope from what we call the teleological perspective. He starts with the end result or the end in mind. And as we look at life and we live from day to day, we must look futuristically into life to see or think about the end result. As Christians, we know that the promises is Jesus is coming back again. But life is a journey. There is many years and days and months and Sundays in between the time that Jesus actually comes back again. We saw the great philosophers, Aristotle, Kant, Paley, write from this notion of this end in mind, or these end consequences, basically suggesting to you and I today that the decisions we make today will impact or have some consequence, whether negative or rather positive. And as we post this particular text today, and we think about this journey in life, I was raised by two grandparents that were not college educated. As a matter of fact, they never even graduated high school. But they would say strange stuff as they would sit me down and tell me stories of how black people were lynched. They would talk about how they had to quit school and work in the field. And Lord knows they had some strange rules that I did not understand. I remember we got our washer and our dryer in. You know, they could use the washer and dryer. They would allow me to use the washer, but I had to hang my clothes on the clothesline simply because I wasn't contributing to the light bill. Didn't understand that. They had rules in the house where you had to do certain things. You couldn't dare go out the door with a bonnet on your head, your last name mixed in it, or a certain way that you had to dress. And every now and then, my grandmother would turn me over to the hands of my Aunt Rita, who I'm still praying that God have a little mercy for all the time she beat us and how she would make us clean up. And she was just so immaculate. Her house is still immaculate. You have to kind of take your shoes off when you go there because you don't want to mess up anything. But it was a time that we would talk principles and we would talk values. And everybody in the neighborhood could whoop you. I didn't understand that. How many whoopings could one child take? You get a beat at school. You get a beat from the neighbor down the street. Then you go home, and when they tell you, you're going to get another beat all over again. But it was a time of true community, a true time of us where the whole village was engaged in raising the child. And as we think about this journey of life, Paul teaches us in this text that if we're going to finish well, the first thing we must do is we must have a peculiar perspective. Paul starts this text and he says, "Brethren, I do not regard myself as having laid hold of it yet." He uses this Greek word, gizomai, here, legizomai, where he talks about this notion of regard, this perspective, this inner looking at himself. And if we're going to have this peculiar perspective, yeah, we first must be able to take our own personal inventory. And this is something that we struggle at. Most of us come to church with a rake instead of a shovel. But if you're going to finish well in life, you have to be able to look yourself in the mirror and deal with the man or woman living in the mirror. And I will tell you, as you're taking that analysis, you're going to find that you have both defects and assets. You have both good and bad. And I know young people, y'all come in and we kind of play games and we try to fool y'all like we've had it together all the time. We've never done nothing or said anything. But I'm here to tell you, we are here every day struggling just like you. It's always amazing to me when I hear my bio and I hear the wonderful things of God. But what my bio doesn't tell you is that 33 years ago, I lived homeless on the streets battling with addiction. My bio does not tell you the number of times that I've been arrested. My bio doesn't tell you that I got pregnant and dropped out of college at Florida A&M. My bio doesn't tell you all the things I've done that I won't say on record because I don't know if the statute of limitation has expired yet. But we have to be able to take a personal inventory of ourselves and understand that we are human beings having a real live experience. And sometimes we're going to mess up. Sometimes we're not going to get it right. And as Paul is writing, Paul has gone through this reckoning with himself. And he's come to the understanding that he was Saul of Tarsus, where he persecuted Christians. He was just a straight up, if I could just say it like those young people said, he was just a straight up thug gangbanger, where he would persecute Christians and he would put them in jail. He was actually on the road to Damascus, going to do some assault and battery on some Christians when God arrested him on the road to Damascus and changed his life. And once God changed Paul's life, Paul began to accelerate. Paul was born as a Roman, but he was also a Jew and a Hebrew. So Paul spoke at least three different languages and probably more. He studied at some of the best universities. We would call them Ivy League schools today. But Paul had all of these successes that came after his failure, after him being a witness in the martyr of Stephen. And now he has all of these good things going on his life, where simultaneously he's being arrested over and over again simply for preaching the gospel. He will definitely be a habitual offender and be fighting to get his rights restored and probably to pay his fines if he was living today. But Paul comes to this particular place in this text with the proper perspective, the particular perspective, and he says, I have not attained it yet. I want to say to somebody, you have been down and you have been up. You have accomplished a lot. You may have letters in front of or behind your name, GED, PhD, ABC, MBC. It's so much stuff now I can't keep up with it. But can I tell you that God is not through with you yet? There is always more to God. You may be a student and you're about to graduate high school. You may have just made a major accomplishment. Maybe you are a superstar athlete. But with God in this journey of life, there is always more. Paul talks about this particular perspective. Those of us that were athletes, Paul uses the analogy here of a runner running a race. Makes me think about my son who used to do track. He would do the first event, which was the high jump and the triple jump of the race, and he would also do the last event, which was the 4x4 relay. And in the 4x4 relay, you have four people running, and they all have to literally sprint one lap around the track as they pass the baton to each other. And if you're going to take this particular perspective, you gotta know what your strengths and what your weakness is as you're doing this game of life. My son would either run second or fourth in the race. He didn't start out. The person that starts out the race, they have to set a tone. But what he was is he had his mama spirit. He was never gonna let anybody beat him. So if somebody was in front of him, he was gonna go catch them every time. Now, I didn't do track, but just a little bit, because I wasn't a track. But I was a basketball player. And this man here, y'all trustee Trump, God gonna deal with him too for all the suicide that he needed to make us, that he used to make us run. But when you are dealing and you are an athlete, you have to do the part of conditioning. And life is a journey where you're going to learn through the good, bad, and different. I never figured out, Truck, how when one person missed the layup, y'all would take us back to practice and make the whole team run instead of the person that just missed the layup. But that's another conversation for another time. Not only must you have a particular perspective, but you also must have a progressive foci. Paul says, I'm forgetting those things behind, and I'm reaching toward those things that are forward. Right. The progressive foci in forgetting does not mean that you erase it out your mind. It means that it no longer has an impact on you. That's right. You forget what has happened, that it's not impacted you. The lie that somebody told on you, the word that somebody spoke against you, the person that mishandled you. And we are imperfect people. We're going to mishandle each other. We're going to disappoint each other. And some of us have been turned over to the hands of some evil people that hurt us real bad. But we have to get to a point in God where those things are not still influencing our decision or minimizing our abilities and our possibilities. Paul talks about this progressive foci. He says, I'm forgetting, but I'm reaching. And when we know when we're in this game of track and we're running this race, it's always going forward. You're always reaching toward that finish line as you're running. And sometimes in life, when you are a dream, people won't see you for who you really are. I think about playing basketball. I see the former chief of police, Mr. Anthony Williams, for the Broward County School Board over there. And Ant was an avid quarterback, but he was also an avid point guard. And me being as tall as I am, I've been 5'11", size 9.5 shoes since sixth grade. I played in the post, a long time. And people used to do just like that, laugh at me. But I was also an expert at watching wrestling. I knew some moves would stop me from laughing. Look at me. Some of y'all would use that on the way home. But when you have a point guard, sometimes in life, people are going to overlook you. And when you're playing a game of basketball and the point guard is bringing the ball down, you really like it when the team is in the zone. When they're the man-to-man, you got to work a little harder because somebody got to set a pick for you for you to get free. But if they're in the zone and you're a post player, you're going to be moving around that part of the court there where you're trying to get open for them. And you know as a good post player, what you're going to do is get on the block or get on the free throw, and you're going to post up and you're going to put that player on your back. Do I have it right, Truck? Did you teach me that? You're going to put that player on your back. Because if they're on your back, if you move right or left, they're going to be on your back. They can't stop you. But every now and then, you have to make sure that the point guard see you. You got to put your hand up and sometimes both of them and beg for the ball. And if you are a part of the dream, God has gifted you. He's given you something that the world needs to see.
you to make a difference in this world. When people look at Paul, he started out on the wrong track. They will probably say things like Paul was never going to amount to anything, but he had this massive encounter with God, and now God is using him for his glory. He's using him for a bigger cause. Yeah. And when you look at life with the end in mind, you understand that it's not just about you. It's not about the neighborhood you live in. It's not about the church you serve in. Yeah. It is a bigger picture. God says that we should go to Jerusalem, Samaria, Judea, and even to the end of the earth. It's a global perspective when the way that God uses us. I'm a little nappy-headed girl from the 33311. All I wanted to do is make a difference for kids. I ended up on the school board 10 years. Now, as a person whose name, when you get arrested, they take your name away from you, and they give you some digits that they identify you. Every time I walk into Florida Senate, and I see a seat there with my last name on it, I know that there's a God, and I know that I'm a part of a dream. And I stop right here to tell somebody today, you may be struggling, you may be going through something, somebody may be bullying at you and picking at you because of the way you look, but when you are a part of a dream, you can't be stopped. But you gotta have a progressive focus. As you're forgetting what's behind, you gotta be reaching to the future. You gotta be reaching in forward, in the forward. As that runner is running that relay race, that runner has that finish line in mind. That runner has that progressive foci. And as we park here for a moment in Black history, my favorite Black history character in the Bible, my favorite Black history character is Araminta. Her name was Araminta. She was born to her parents. She changed it 20 years later. You know her by the name of Harriet Tubman. Yeah. And what I like about Harriet Tubman, she wasn't the best looking sister. She never even learned how to read and write. But because she was a part of the dream, she had something on the inside of her that she knew that she was not born to be nobody's slave. She never accepted what people were saying, the title that she was given as a slave. She was never going to settle with that. Her story says, as a matter of fact, that the master was encountering a slave, and she stepped in the middle of it and got hit in the head with something that caused her to have a permanent scar and permanent damage, where she would have seizures and she would have headaches. She never learned how to read and write, but because she knew she was a part of the dream, she just kept on trusting God, and God would eventually teach her how to use the stars and the gifts and talents of working in the field, not only to free herself, but to go back over a 10-year period of time and free others and free more people over and over again. Because when you are a part of a dream, it's not just about you. It's what you're doing to make the world a better place for others. When you're a part of a dream, you're not okay with just being free. You want everybody to be free. Black history also talks about another name that you're probably not even familiar with, because she's a young girl, a 15-year-old young girl by the name of Claudette Colvin. She was actually the first person in Alabama that refused to give up her seat about 9 months prior to Rosa Parks. But the story has it that she was a little more dark-skinned. You know, she didn't fit the bill. You know, at that time, they had a preference about which one of us they preferred. But this Black girl, 15 years old, was arrested in Alabama because she would not give up her seat on the bus. She was a young person. And when we look at history, most significant change came about in history as a result of young people leading those movements. So I'm here to tell some of y'all, I'm a millennial born in the wrong generation, so I'm going to just tell y'all what we want to tell y'all. Y'all got to get out of the way and give us some time. Y'all got to get out of the way and help us learn and be developed. Y'all got to stop being so critical on us. We won't learn unless you give us a chance. Yeah, we might wear our hair twisted, and we might even wear our pants sagging sometimes, but it don't mean that God has not made us to be a part of the dream. I just love the remix of the choir. Every now and then, something from the 50s and 60s need a little remix in on it to bring it into the day. And as we keep on with this progressive going, and we look at what Paul is saying to us, and we're running this race in life. We're running this journey. Track player that runs the 440 relay knows that when you get to the last 220 mark, you come off that mark, you're gonna hit that curve. And when you hit that curve, the wind gonna be blowing in your face.
Yeah.
And if you got a good coach, that good coach gonna tell you to lean into the curve. Because when you lean into the curve, it breaks the wind. And once you come off that wind, off that curve and that wind, you're going to catch a second wind, and you're going to strive, and you're going to keep running with your eye on the prize, on the finish line, your eye on that finish line. Paul says, not only must we have a particular perspective, a progressive focus, but brothers and sisters, we have to be prepared to fight. That's the bottom line. If you are a person of color, you gotta be prepared and fight. When that runner hit that last curve and they lean into that curve and they straighten up, you're gonna see them arms moving like they have never moved before because they're prepared to fight. Now I told you I played basketball. And Truck, it made me think about when you in a game and your body's against the wall and it's the last few seconds left, the other team is gonna put what? A full court press on you. And any good basketball player know that you can't dribble your way through a full-court press.
Right.
You gotta have the other men or women on the court in the right place that you can pass the ball to them so that you can get closer to the goal to win. And as these runners are running this 440 relay, they gotta pass that baton four times. And you know that when you're passing a baton, you got to hand it off right in order for the next person to get it. When they put their hand back, as you're pressing and you're reaching forward, you got to put that baton in their hand where they can stride at the same time. Brothers and sisters, Paul says, I press. He says, I'm pursuing. I press toward the mark of a higher call in Christ Jesus. And as we're living in this moment in time in history where things are like we've never seen before, we can't get the goal and the prize mixed up. Paul says, I press toward the call of a higher mark in Christ Jesus. He know the goal was to finish the race, but he know that it was just not enough to finish, that there was also a prize. Think about it. When we run track, we win the track meet, but there's going to be a prize. The person that wins is going to be put on one level, the second person, and the third person. In the game of basketball, we playing to win, but ultimately, you want to win the championship. You want to be better than all the rest. And I stopped by here to tell somebody this morning, no matter how many times you've messed up, no matter what is going on in your life personally, I have a guarantee for your success. I have a guarantee for your win. Paul says, I'm pressing toward the mark of a higher call in Christ Jesus. Can I tell you that you cannot be successful without the Lord? You cannot be successful without our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I remember going to Florida A&M University, and Lord knows I was so happy to leave my grandma's house. I was tired of washing dishes. I didn't understand why mama would cook so much food, and I would have to wash all the dishes from place to people that I didn't even know, that I didn't even eat the food. And mama was a certain way because it was beneath her standards to have paper plates and paper cups. She probably turned over in her grave. Forgive me, mama. I have paper plates and paper cups. But all these dishes would be there, and I would have to wash these dishes. You had all these rules, and Lord knows you had to go to church all the time. And being a tomboy, it was an extra problem for me, because then I had to wear a dress that I literally hated to wear. I wanted to wear Converse. I know y'all young people think y'all created Chucks, but we were supposed Chucks like the Dr. Day Day a long, long time ago. But I had to wear that dress to church. It was not optional. It was no negotiation.
Right.
You were going to go to church on Sundays. You was going to go to Bible study. You was going to go to BTU. It was an all-day thing almost every day that you was going to be up in somebody's church. And a lot of things I couldn't understand in church because some of the old people was a little mean. I know y'all ain't like that now. Y'all nice old people. But some of those old people was a little mean to us in church. But these were things that we had to do. And it put a foundation in us. Everything in life is spiritual. God is a spirit. And everything is spiritual. And as we live from day to day, we're human beings in a broken, frail body, in a broken, sinful world. And we're literally in a battle. We're fighting every day with good and bad. We're right and wrong. And some days, brothers and sisters, we get it wrong. Some days we mess up. Some days our attitudes are not right. Some days we do things that we should not do. But I'm so glad this morning that God's mercies endure forever. I'm so glad this morning that God has created us in his Omega Day, in his image, to live in his Missio Day, in his mission. It is you and me that God has created to be his instrument of salvation to the world. I got a story, you got a story, all God's children got a story, and all those stories point people toward Christ. Is there anybody here this morning that want to be real with me? That know if it was not for the Lord on your side, you wouldn't even be alive this morning. Oh, don't act too with me. Is there anybody here that felt like giving up sometimes? You wanted to throw the towel in. You couldn't see your way out, and God made a way for you. Is there anybody here that's been so low that you strayed so way or so far away from God? You drunk too much. You smoked too much. You did some other things that you didn't even feel connected to God. But good God Almighty, he's the kind of God that leaves the flock of 99 and go find the one lost sheep. And as I close this morning, as we think about what Paul is talking about finishing well, I think we get our ultimate example in Jesus the Christ himself. He was a little boy that was born to two teenage parents. And if I tell the story right, they wasn't even married. Some of y'all Baptist folk wouldn't even want them up in the church. But I'm so glad this morning that every child is a blessing from God. The Bible says that Jesus was born in a manger. Born in a manger with animals. Was from the wrong family, the wrong side of town. But I'm so glad this morning that when somebody said, could anything good come out of Nazareth? Can anything good come out of this trunk? Can anything good come out of Dillard Homes? Can anything good come out of Mount Nebo? Can anything good come out of Carroll City? Can anything good come out of Duval? I'm so glad this morning that my Jesus was a part of the dream. A dream for me and a dream for you. The Bible says that he came down to 42 generation because God had a goal to give me and you a prize. Good God Almighty, I feel my help coming on. I'm so glad this morning that the story didn't stop there. My Jesus had to press. He had to press his way to the Via Della Rosa. He had to press his way through the Garden of Gethsemane. Look, God Almighty, he had to press his way through Calvary. He had to forget those things that were behind and reach toward the mark of a higher calling. He said, Father, forgive them. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. The Bible says, he said, Lord, let this bitter cup pass. When I think about it, Pastor McKenzie, that bitter cup was my sins, and it was your sins, and I a victory, but a prize. The Bible says he's coming back again. And when he comes back, we'll get our prize in that place where there'll be no more racism, no more discrimination, no more gun violence, no more suicide, no more heartache, and no more pain. My brothers and sisters, keep pressing and finish well. God bless you.
Invitation of discipleship. Finish well. What a word. What a word. What a word. Y'all give another hand. Amen. We offer Christ to you this morning. Amen. If you don't know Christ in the palm of your sins, today is a good day to come on the Lord's side and live. We offer Christ. We offer Christ to you.
Church say amen. What a word, what a word. Senator Rosalind Osgood this morning. Finish well. Amen. So many entered the race, but they never finished the race. Amen. But God has called us to keep pressing forward. Amen? Amen. 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 Keep telling the story. How we overcome. We'll understand it better by and by. Amen. We want to ask for your assistance. Today is our, not only our Black History program, but today is our also our scholarship fundraiser, which we receive funds today that we may give out scholarship to worthy students, as you see in the choir stand. Say amen, somebody. Amen. You've been to school and graduated, you know it costs money. Education is not free. Come on, don't get quiet now. You were just jumping and shouting when Dr. Osgood was up here preaching. Amen. And if you have children that you are sending to school, or grandchildren that you are providing some financial assistance to, that takes money. And it takes money besides tuition and books. They need to eat too. Come on, help me somebody today. They still need clothes. They still need their hair done. I don't have any hair, but they still need their hair done. Amen. Takes money. Our goal, that's Mount Nebo Missionary Baptist Church, in honor of the late Dr. Moses E. Monroe and Edna Monroe, is to continue to drop a little pebble in the ocean to create that ripple effect. Every dollar makes a difference. Every dollar makes a difference. We've asked the members of Mount Nebo to give $30 on today as a special love offering for our Joy Scholarship. Now, I know I should have at least the scholarship committee saying something with me. But as I look out, the scholarship committee is just as quiet as everybody else. Amen. If I don't have no help from nobody else, I ought to have some help from the scholarship committee. We need your help. We need your help. We believe in sowing into the lives of prospective students. We believe in helping them along the way. No, we may not be giving out $20, $30, $40, $50,000 scholarships, but that $1,000 makes a difference. Come on in here this morning. And these are our children. Come on, talk to me. These are not some children that we know nothing about. These are our children from our churches, from our communities, that we are endeavoring to help them along the way. Because one day they may be that very doctor that has to help you. They may be that lawyer that has to get you out of a situation that you didn't even intend to be in. They may even be that senator who's writing legislation that has an impact on our community. Talk to me today. We never know how far the ripple effect will be, but it's up to us to create it. Amen? If you are our guest and you would like to help us in this endeavor, we would greatly appreciate it. Certainly make all your checks payable to Mount Nebo Missionary Baptist Church, but in your comment section, if you would please notate that it is for the Joy Scholarship. 30 is what we've asked, but you can always give more. You can give $29.99. We'll take that too. Where are my offering persons? You see this young man here, Deacon Paul Jones, and his African attire. If you need an envelope, on the envelope there is a space for the scholarship. If you can notate your gift there, that would be great as well. If you need one, please raise your hand. You can also give electronically. You can give via Givelify, Zelle, or if you're going to give your contribution via debit card or credit card, someone in the classroom two on your right from our financial ministry will receive you. Or cash is still king.
Amen.
Amen. Whatever you give on today, give it from your heart. We would greatly appreciate whatever gift you give. Amen?
Amen?
We're going to pray and then we're going to give on today. Father, we thank you now for these gifts that we're about to receive. Bless every hand, bless every home, bless every scholarship recipient that this little small gift, this little small token of love will make a great difference in their life and their educational pursuits. Bless their minds, give them fresh understanding, give them new creative ideas as they go forth in this world, becoming the men and the women that you have created them to be. Help them to finish well, O God. This we ask and pray in Jesus' name, amen. I'm gonna ask you to stand, ask our overflow to come around first, followed by
God. I wanted to acknowledge we have someone, a guest that's here. I wanted to acknowledge the Vice Mayor for the City of Lauderdale Lakes, Vice Mayor Carlene Maxwell Williams. Amen. You understand? Amen. Thank you for joining us today. There's been a slight change in our program. want to have the acknowledgement of our Mount Eagle supporters.
Those that are with us, time for, we just want to make sure that everyone gets an opportunity to hear. Thank you to those who have supported us and been with us on today. And I'm going to ask if we can have, thank you so much, if we can have Sister Cora, if you would please come up, Sister Karen, Sister Teresa, she just went into the kitchen. We have Sister Willis, if you'll please come up. And Sister Lattimore. I think she's with us today. Okay. We're going to ask Horace Steele come and stand by our side. He's the chair. And he's the chair. Amen. Y'all got that? Of our scholarship committee, of course, Pastor McKenzie as well. So with that, I do just want to just say a special, special thank you to you, Pastor McKenzie, of course, for everything that you allow the committee to do on behalf of this program. Amen. So Mount Nebo and family, we want to give a big clap of praise. We do acknowledge and just want to thank you, Mount Nebo family and guests. Give yourselves a hand clap of praise. Amen. For today, awesome to be God. We want to thank the Mount Nebo Voices, all the program participants, and to Florida Memorial University Choir. Amen. We got a person waiting here. She's named after Johnson. This lady, she's an unsung hero to me. Silent in all she does, but mighty. Amen. For the years that I've known her. And we just thank God. She's a dynamic minister of music. We thank God for what she always shares. To our Mount Nebo young people, I cannot forget them. They are so welcome. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Y'all for here today. Open, thank you, thank you, thank you. And to our guest speaker. Amen. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Every time we have asked, you've been right there, and every time you deliver. Amen. She's relevant. As she said, she's the millennial in the age, I'm a millennial in the age. Amen. We're radical. We're that group. Yeah. Ask us and we will talk. Amen. So we thank God for you. Thank God for what you brought to us today. And one reason, again, why I'm standing here, I do want to acknowledge they were able to make it. And that's why I jumped up here before anyone left. We want to acknowledge we have Monroe descendants here with us today, amen, that came all the way from Boone. So we want to have them stand, amen. And we have the granddaughter, Lisa. We have the granddaughter, Tiffany, amen.
Yeah.
And is this?
Scholarship Committee for assembling a great program on today, as well as all of our participants, and most of all, Florida Memorial. Amen. Come on, come on, come on. Give it up, give it up. Amen. Certainly to our speaker, Dr. Osgood. Awesome job, always, always done. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, the love of God, the sweet communion of his Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with you, his people, henceforth, now, and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.